what we're looking at here in terms of climate emergency can be boiled down to this. The science was always clear. That pulse of carbon into the atmosphere and what it would do to global climate systems was identified first in 1896. Burning fossil fuels to drive our economy was understood from the get-go to be a threat to climate stability. Then scientists began to look at it again, and by the 1970s, reports to the United States, to the White House, reports to Canadian politicians began to pour in. In other words, the world scientists have never doubted. It's like add salt to water, you get salt water. Add warming gases to the planet's atmosphere, you get a warming, destabilized planetary system. So we were warned. If we'd done what we set out to do in the late 1980s or 1992 when we signed the Framework Convention on Climate Change, the things that you see on these charts would never have happened. We wouldn't have had inevitable retreating glaciers. We would not have inevitable rising sea levels. We would not have increasing forest fires. We would not have increased 100-year flood events every couple of years. We wouldn't have killer heat waves. We wouldn't have a melting Arctic. We wouldn't have a melting Greenland ice sheet. The scientific conference here in Toronto in June 1988 began with the following sentence as a consensus statement of the world's scientists. Humanity is conducting an unintended, uncontrolled, globally pervasive experiment whose ultimate consequences could be second only to global nuclear war. Between 1992 and now, we have emitted globally more greenhouse gases and burned more fossil fuels than we did between the Industrial Revolution and 1992. We were warned. We took steps. Governments made promises. And we have gone in the wrong direction, hell-bent towards extinction. Why do we do this? No wonder Greta Thunberg from Stockholm stands up in rooms and says, I want you to panic. I want you to act as though the house is on fire, because our house is on fire. The other parties are saying, there's no fire. It's fine. There's a piece of toast stuck in the toaster. That's our problem. Others say, yeah, there's a fire. It's pretty serious, but we think it's confined to the upstairs bedroom. And the Raptors game is on, so we can chill. Now, the target that you saw up on the screen, our nationally determined contribution, has nothing whatsoever to do with what we negotiated in Paris. But it's called, almost universally in this country, Canada's Paris target. Bill McKibben, such a wonderful leader of our movement, a dear friend of mine, and he said, you know, on most political issues, he said, well, there's this hardcore position over here, and there's another position over here, and in politics, the job is to find something in the middle. Except, as Bill says, you can't negotiate with physics. This, the course that saves us, is the only course. And anything over here in incremental baby steps, tweaking things, is as useless as doing nothing. It's hard. It's a hard reality for those who think they've done a lot by bringing in a carbon price. It's made to look like a lot through the reckless actions of politicians who think it's too much. But the hard reality for Canadians in this election is that getting it right is critical to our children's future, and we have one chance to get it right. So here's what happened between the last draft, the penultimate draft of the October 8th, 2018 report and the one that was issued. Saudi Arabia and the US went to work on the text and got some of the scariest bits removed. The scariest bits were the text that explains what happens if we go to 2. What's the difference in impacts between 1.5 degrees Celsius and 2 degrees Celsius? It remains clear that somewhere south of 2 degrees, we run an unacceptable risk of hitting the tipping point into self-accelerating, unstoppable, runaway global warming, which would mean there's a point in the not-too-distant future when we won't be able to do anything to stop global warming. I regarded the IPCC report on October 8th as really good news, because what they said was, we have time. What they said was, we can still hold to no more than 1.5 degrees. We can promise people that we can hold on to enough of the frozen permafrost that we don't have all the methane that's up there to the atmosphere. That's critical. We can be sure that the Arctic will be covered with ice most of the time. We'll get one summer ice-free day at the North Pole once every 10 years if we hold to 1.5 degrees. If we go to 2, all bets are off. Secretary General of the United Nations is holding an emergency climate summit. All governmental leaders from around the world are begged to attend, to show up so that they can have their feet put to the fire and be asked and demanded, what is your new target? Where is your target that is consistent with the advice we have from scientists? Because we're not going to get another chance. If targets aren't improved within the next 12 to 24 months, you can't possibly achieve the economic transformations that are required by 2030. I'm calling for us in Canada to do something amazing, which is a campaign strike. That we all stop campaigning against each other for long enough to go to New York, to the United Nations, and let us participate. This issue is too important for partisanship. I think that's pretty obvious. Our children's lives are at stake. We're going into an election where I get questions like, well, are Canadians really ready for bold action? Listen, I'm going to carry them out of the burning building on my back if I have to. We need the equivalent of a wartime cabinet with all the leaders of the parties in the same room. We need a climate emergency cabinet that drives a course to survival. My dad, who passed away a few years ago, grew up in London, just outside of it, in Barnet, during the Blitz. Before he could join the army, his life was in danger all the time, just getting home from school. The local accountant at the mill was killed in the Blitz, and all of the men who could have taken his place were already in the war. So my dad at 16 became the accountant for the local mill in his community. So it was a surprise to me. It was before I got involved in the Green Party, and I was fighting and he was helping. We were all fighting offshore oil and gas development that was being proposed for the coasts of Cape Breton Island. My dad said to me one day, you know, I think I really preferred the Second World War. Back in those days, we really had the feeling the government was on our side. Wouldn't it be great if our kids knew their government was on their side? My daughter's 28. By the time she's 65, by God, there must be a livable world, or I will have failed as a mother. We will have failed as a society. We have failed as a species, and I am not prepared to tell my daughter we are a failed species, and neither are any of you, and neither are any of the parliamentarians with whom I work. I just want to leave you with this. We can do this. The Greens have dubbed our climate plan Mission Possible, because it's possible. We need all hands on deck. We understand the climate emergency. We know our way out of the burning building, and we're leaving no one behind. Thank you.